Hello, welcome. We are back with Sci-Fi Reality Check. I'm Beth Johnson. This is my co-host,
Franck Marchis.
And we are from the SETI Institute, and we are pleased to be returning with a look at the rest of season two of Strange New Worlds in anticipation of season three. So let's get the show on the road, shall we?
Yeah, let's do this. Let's talk about science and science fiction.
And in case you're not aware, if you haven't seen these episodes yet, and really, why haven't you at this point? Spoiler alert, there will be spoilers. We will be talking about plot. So you are forewarned.
So watch the show first, and then watch us.
And then come back and watch us. All right, so let's get this started. We're going to do episode three, tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow, and I will try not to quote the rest of Hamlet from that. So this episode involves some time travel. That's kind of exciting. You get your prototypical time travel episode. So LANL goes back in time to, of all places, Toronto. And she drags James Kirk with her. So it's a whole bunch of fun going on here. Yeah. All right.
And there's a lot of story, but we're not going to talk about
that. And there's a lot of story, but we're not going to talk about the story because we are here to talk about the science. So Franck, let's start with the big question. Is time travel possible?
Yeah, well, time travel is theoretically possible, I would say. You know that time is part of the space continuum.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
We have this idea that's, in fact, Einstein got this idea that with general relativity, that there is a link between the space and time. Mm-hmm. In fact, it's the same into the space continuum. So you should be able to travel in time as much as you should be able to travel in space. However, modification of time requires a lot of energy. And also, because we can travel at different speed in time, if we travel at different speed, you have a different perception of the time.
Mm-hmm.
That's one thing. So if I put you in a rocket and I send you to Mars at the speed close to the speed of light, your time perception will be different to mine.
Right.
Right. Then you can also create gravity. So if you live on the top of a mountain, your time will be slower than if you live close to the sea, because the gravity is different.
The gravity, right.
So if you want to slow down time, you can just create a very strong gravity. We don't know how to do that yet.
No.
Okay. And then...
Problem one with this episode. Okay.
Then we have to use the magical wormhole.
Yes.
Can you explain to us what is a wormhole?
So for those of you who have seen some of our Stargate SG-1 episodes... wormholes are basically a shortcut across space. They essentially create a pathway between two very distant points that you can now travel at much higher speeds and get across the galaxy, and in the case of Stargate Atlantis, across parts of the universe. So it's a very deeply theoretical concept. And the one that I've kind of heard, I think, the most is sort of like, if you take a black hole and the fact that it's so gravitationally dense that there's a possibility on the other side of it would be like we would call a white hole, where information can come out the other side of it, because information should not be able to be destroyed or lost. So it has to go somewhere. And no one's found a white hole. So
all of these are, as we say, purely theoretical.
Yeah.
So in the story, LANL met this time traveler, and they have a tiny device, smaller than your iPhone, and they press a button, and poof, they disappear, and they go to
another time.
And another space.
And another space, because this is one of the things that Doctor Who does, right? If you understand that the abbreviation for TARDIS is time and relative dimension in space, it's because you can't just go to a time, you need a space. So you have to have your fourth dimension, basically. You have to have all four. You can't just, like, if I were to go back in time right here and not move, there would be no planet.
Exactly.
That would be bad.
Because the planet move, you know, around the sun. So.
Yeah, so you have to, and the sun is moving around the galaxy, so everything's in constant motion. So you have to know all of these details
to be able to get exactly where you want when you want.
Exactly. So to pop yourself into a Toronto street on a specific date and time, that's a bit of a challenge.
And that's science fiction, right?
It's very science fiction. Okay. It's very science fiction. Very not science, more fiction.
Okay. So we agree on that.
Yes.
Okay.
I hate time travel, people.
Okay. So they go back to Toronto, mm-hmm. and they find out why they have been sent to Toronto at a specific time.
Yes.
Maybe you can tell a bit the story of the bridge, right?
Yeah. So one of the things that Lana is told by the time traveler is that she needs to get to the bridge. And of course, her immediate reaction is that she needs to get to the bridge of the Enterprise. But it turns out, no, it's a bridge in Toronto that is being blown up. That apparently happens, and this is where time gets really sticky. So these two people, La'an and Kirk, are coming from completely separate timelines. So they don't exist the same way, mm-hmm. either side. In fact, based on Kirk's, La'an may not exist at all.
Yeah.
So, but the whole thing is that they're trying to stop this bridge. Well, they can't stop it from being destroyed. That happens in both. But the cause of it is different in both of them. And that's where they have to figure out why, what happened. And so La'an notices that it's caused by what she called a photonic bomb. So mm-hmm. I'm guessing,
which is a technology that does not exist. Science fiction.
Yeah, again, science fiction. It's a bomb of light, essentially, mm-hmm. like a ton of light particles. And it doesn't exist in the time that they are in. And it barely exists in the time that La'an is from. So it shouldn't be there, which leads them to believe, you know, obviously there's some sort of alien influence. They meet up with a so-called reporter who seems a little on the crazy side of things with conspiracy theories and all of this. But it turns out, yeah, not so much.
She's a Romulan.
I did not see the twist coming when I first watched the episode. Did you?
I noticed that she was always wearing a beanie and
okay.
So I was wondering what she was hiding underneath that.
Fair enough.
But you know, it's Toronto is always cold, so
exactly.
Maybe the Canadians say, no, it's not always
cold in Toronto. I've been in Toronto when it's not cold, so it's fine. But I really didn't see it coming. But yeah, so this reporter turns out to be the Romulan who has been sent back in time to basically blame aliens for this destruction of the bridge, so that the
Starfleet doesn't exist,
the Federation of Planets doesn't exist, we're not helping out the Vulcans, so
we
now
don't trust the extraterrestrial species, we don't help them,
we don't develop, we don't advance very quickly, so it's a whole thing to slow Earth down and keep us from making these advances.
And this is called
the butterfly effect. So what's the butterfly effect?
So the butterfly effects come from the idea that a tiny change far away can change, a chaotic system can totally change the way the system would behave in the future. So this butterfly effect comes from the idea that if you have a butterfly flying in Singapore, this small perturbation may become a tornado that will basically destroy a city in North America. It's an example. So that's the idea that a small perturbation can amplify and become basically a chaotic system, in a chaotic system, and produce something significantly bigger in terms of in amplitude.
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, the change of the timeline, this explosion of the bridge, and basically the blaming of the aliens and the killing of a few people will basically allow jeopardize the idea of the Starfleet,
mm-hmm.
and will create a society which is much more militarized.
Insular, so they're not helping the Vulcans. So that gives the Romulans freedom to go after the Vulcans, mm-hmm. more thoroughly, come after Earth later.
And the destroyers, yes.
Right. So, and one of the things that they actually prevent from happening, La'an and Kirk, is blowing up this cold fusion reactor. But it turns out there's like a whole secondary thing with the butterfly effect, and that's that La'an's ancestor Khan Noonien Singh from the Wrath of Khan is a genocidal maniac that they need to allow to live,
yeah.
in order for Earth to progress to this state of chaos and war that allows warp. It all gets a little,
this is an interesting point. If you can travel in the past, do you want to save everybody from a genocide, knowing that from this you learn, that society we learn and we become better, or you basically let this happen? And that's really the key part of this episode.
Yeah.
Basically, she has to take a decision.
Yeah.
Is she going to kill her own ancestor, knowing what he's going to do, or is she going to let him leave?
Yeah, and that's a rough position to be put in. And again, it comes back to that butterfly effect. Like, where do you draw the line on what changes you're going to make?
And so you can change one thing because it appeared to be obvious.
Yeah.
But maybe something else will happen, which should be 10 times worse.
Exactly.
You don't know that.
Exactly. And so she just chooses to preserve her own timeline the way it is, warts and all, I guess.
Yeah.
Best way to look at it.
So something a little bit more light. Can
yeah.
we talk about our famous alien? I mean, the one we like the most.
Oh, Pelia. Pelia has my heart. I think I mentioned this early on when we did episode one. Pelia has my heart. So, I mean, I love the actress. I love the character. She's just, she gives you that comic relief you kind of need, but also, you know, that aging wisdom. So,
why is she in this
episode? So Pelia is a lanthanide. I hope I said that right. And she's basically this, like, it almost eternally lived species, but capable of existing on Earth in a way that no one knows that she is. So she is an engineer in La'an's time. She's now working on board the Enterprise. She has a very interesting history, which, because she mentions in passing, and that's kind of a Chekhov's gun scenario, isn't it? It's sort of like, oh, she's mentioned that there was this, she had this place in Vermont. This will become relevant later. La'an goes to her hoping for her engineering skills.
And it happened that she's totally not really
totally,
savvy in engineering.
Totally
she
not
has some
engineer.
Great idea, but she doesn't know much about engineering.
No, she's an antiquities dealer in the genre of, if you don't really care about the provenance of your antiquities.
Yes, she's stealing art, basically.
She's stealing art, yeah.
Okay. Well, what I like in this character, to go back, is this idea that we could have aliens living among us if they know how to mimic our physical appearance.
Mm-hmm. It's a really interesting idea, and kind of one that plays out a lot in the Star Trek universe. And I think there's a whole Next Generation thread about that, where, you know, the universe got seeded with, a DNA type of structure that caused all of these different races to, you know, be these bipedal,
mm-hmm.
two-eyed, two arms, you know, relatively similarly structured species all over the place. And so that, if that is the case, then yeah, you would have species.
You have a lot of species kind of similar.
That are kind of similar, that could maybe hide amongst each other. I mean, you have a Romulan who can wear a beanie and
and be completely
human. Unobvious. Yeah. Although I think there was some disguise tech involved there too, yeah. But yeah.
Yeah, those, I like this idea. And I like this character lives through history of humanity. So she mentioned that she met was Pythagore.
Yeah, she made the comment about, I haven't studied math since Pythagoras invented the stuff.
And it was stupid. It was useless. So something like
that. Yeah, something like that. And she
okay.
just...
So interestingly, why did she become an engineer? Maybe because in the Talam and La'an, she remember she met her and she didn't have any engineering skills. So she took the time, the thousands of years that she had,
hundred
years to basically learn engineering.
Yeah, I really like that kind of callback to it, where it's sort of like, yeah, you've got a good mind for engineering, and it's like, oh, you know, and then that in actuality, all of this was sort of meant to happen this way, because then she does become the engineer,
yeah.
And she does end up on the Enterprise, and that is where, like, the time travel thing always drives me kind of bonkers, because, like, then you have to kind of go back and reevaluate every single one of Pelia's interactions with La'an and say, like, because of that, she should know who La'an is, should recognize her. So,
You overthinking it, right?
I do.
Yeah, I spent my evening doing that too, and I think that was a bad idea. Okay. Well, I think that's all for this episode. I was very surprised that they came back in our century.
Mm.
And they make some comments about our society, about our attachment to money, for instance, and things like that. So
yeah, it's really interesting how they're trying to apply. Like, I think there's the point where La'an's like, you need to start thinking about like all of your history classes that you took, you know, when you were going through whatever academy you went through and whatever I went through, and we figure out like, remember how this works. Watching Kirk try and drive a car when this Kirk has never lived on Earth.
Yeah.
So, you know, there were a lot of things that were definitely that those little tiny pieces to it that were kind of fun to add into a you know, your typical time travel episode.
And show that if you're a time traveler, you come from the future, you may be detected very quickly because you're unable to drive a car. You're unable to understand the concept of money.
Right.
And you play chess so well that you basically beat everybody.
Exactly.
So look around. If you see someone super smart or super weird, don't be upset at him or her. Maybe they're coming from the future.
They could be coming from the future. They could be an alien here in our midst. And I know some of you will probably say that they are, and that's fine. And if you are here, welcome. Enjoy what's left of our planet. All right, Franck.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And we will be back soon to talk about episode 4 and memory loss.
See you soon.
See you soon. Bye.